Hey there. Have you ever asked yourself what it really means to design with content first or content first design, and how that actually helps accessibility, and how can you start with it? What does that actually mean when you're building a site? Hi, I am PICCIA, and in this series of videos, I'm showing you how the team and I are building the new website for the Galleria Nazionale dell'Umbria, where this one is the old one, and we're building a new one. And we're now in the final build phases. But what is really important to me, and I want to talk to you about, is how we really led the process content first. And now that we're getting to the build of the site, we have actually already structured it in a way that we know will be accessible. And I'll show you how we did that. First of all, let me recommend this Content First Design article on the wonderful Balsamiq Wireframing Academy, where the content determines the design. How do we do that? Well, if you watch the videos in this series, you'll see that Content First Design, as it says here, it's an approach where the content for your project determines the design of the site. And how did we do that? We found out what we were trying to communicate to our audience, the stories we were trying to tell, and the actions that we want our users to take on the site with a lot of research. A content first site, more often than not, will be already accessible. And accessibility is something that is hugely important to me. This is the first thing to bear in mind. So when you're working with artworks, really you must, in my opinion, make sure that your visual style doesn't drown the artwork, because really the design has to serve the artwork. So the interesting thing is that there are no branding guidelines to draw from. So it's, in a way, I find it's a hindrance, because guidelines actually help you out. Even so though, I feel like there are visual guidelines for the reason that I just said, because you have to accompany the artwork and not drown it. And then also because this website has existed for years, and the same company, Mutnik, also deal with all the signage inside the gallery. So there is a visual style that we have to bear in mind, because brand recognition is very important. These are the things that I bear in mind: existing guidelines, existing visual style, and the fact that the design for a museum needs to accompany the artworks and not overwhelm them. How do we achieve that? Well, I'll show you something. So first of all, we hired a UX writer who's been looking at all our content and rewriting it, and also writing a style guide and a UX writing guide. Why? Because you need consistency. Look at how Alicia has been rewriting the pages. Alicia is the name of our UX writer. So if you look at the Google Doc that she created for the main page, the About page of the museum, we have a URL, we have an SEO title, and an SEO description. So accessible content is SEO friendly, so it's gonna rank your site higher. This is why it's so important. So we have an SEO title, and we have an SEO description and for the page. And then look at how she structured the page. So we have a heading one, that's the title of the page, the Museum of the Galleria Nazionale dell'Umbria. Then the content is being translated as we speak. And so I've only translated the headings, because I'm not the translator for this project, thankfully. So then is followed by a heading two, which is about the history of the museum. Then within this paragraph, within this heading two, is the opening to the public, because it has to do with the history of the museum. So it's a heading three inside, nested inside the heading two. And nested inside this is another heading, which is heading four, which is the first date of opening of this museum. Pinacoteca means a museum that's only paintings. That's what it is. And then we have another heading two, because it has a slightly different topic. Now, you could have two heading threes, or even two heading twos, but you can never have more than one heading one. So the way that Alice has structured the content for the page is something that is going to be interpreted by a screen reader incredibly easily, because the way a screen reader visits your page is that it goes to it and it scans what the headings are so that it can get an idea of the hierarchy of content and what matters the most and first. So already you're going to know what the main topic is, which is the museum, then the history, and because the screen reader can do a list, you can ask the screen reader to list the headings. And of course, it will list them in order of importance, and this is what it's going to do. Therefore, this page is already SEO optimized, and it's completely readable by a screen reader. Now, if you think that not that many people who are temporarily or permanently disabled visit your site, no, that's not the case. About 25% of the people that visit your site actually need an accessible site. Therefore, if you make your site accessible, you will immediately get 25% more audience than you would normally have, which is extraordinary. I mean, think about all the marketers, you know, how all the techniques that they sell you to get, like, you know, 5% increase is already huge. So 25%, what are you waiting for? Make sure that your site is accessible, and it starts from content. Now, I want to show you an example. It's for a wonderful museum, Peggy Guggenheim collection. It's a beautiful website with beautiful artworks. I'm going to show you what it looks like in terms of structure. Now, let me just say, there is no perfect website, but there are tools that you can use to check for accessibility. This Wave Aim extension is something that you can try. One thing that I love to look at, because it really gives you a measure of how important this is the structure. One thing that you can't do is to style your text with headings and other semantic elements. So look at this page. Someone who can't see is going to be very confused by this website, because look at how many heading one it has. So for instance, these are exhibitions. I can imagine that the reason why they did it is because within their own page, these events are H1s. They're the star of the show. You shouldn't style things like this. You could use an aside, for instance. There are different HTML tags that you can use for styling elements rather than headings. It's not the correct way of doing it. You're not going to help your SEO, number one, and your screen readers. Now, I really want to recommend this YouTube video, which it gives you a lot of obscure HTML elements, but they are the ones that can help you style things that you would be tempted to style in a way that's semantically incorrect. So this is how we did it for the copy. So, and it's the same with, so if we look at the content of the actual works, so a big section of this website is going to be the work descriptions. It's an incredibly great collection, digital collection, of all the artworks that are in the museum. Some of them are going to have gigapixel images. It's going to be amazing. I can't wait. So, and every one of these items is has incredible detail, goes into a lot of detail into the work of art. And we've revisited this because this is obviously, look, it's page 1 of 53 for just one work. So we have obviously created a more non-initiated friendly version, and our UX writer Alice is dealing with it. So the way she structured it, see that she has assigned headings within this, and they are headings 3. I think the title is going to be heading 1, but it's not in this document. Anyway, here again, I have only translated the main headings. So we've got title, author, date of birth, year, media, technique, provenance, alt text for the image. So the image needs a description for Google. So Google can find the image whenever someone is looking for instance, Lello da Velletri, which is the painter who created this painting, and Google is going to find this. So it's alt text is essential, and it's essential both for Google and SEO and for accessibility, because the screen reader is going to find the image and it's going to be able to read it. But what we've done, so this is the artwork, this is a description that Alice was briefed to make really interesting, like a story, and she's a master storyteller. So each artwork has a description that is very friendly for those who are not art historians, who are not experts, because it tells an interesting, fun, sometimes even moving story about the piece. Then we also have the accessible description. What is the accessible description? It's a description that describes every single aspect of the artwork, because if you don't do this, someone who can't read is not going to understand the story, because the alt text isn't enough. The alt text also only tells me it's a polyptych, which means it's a painting with more than one panel, and it depicts the Virgin with child, two angels, and a few saints, but it doesn't tell me what they're wearing, what they look like, if they're looking right or they're looking left, and so on. So the accessible description is the punctual description of everything that is depicted in the image. And then there's going to be an art historical description, which means that that's for researchers and for art historians. So this is all that we have, and this is how you design by content. This is how content drives design. Now, another thing that was very important to me is, for instance, this is just a rough, it may change, but we have these big typographical openings that I absolutely love. So we agreed that this was not going to be a heading, obviously, because this is an excerpt from the main text. It's probably going to be repeated further down as well, but this is definitely not the heading one. We're never going to use a heading one to style this, which is just an excuse to have wonderful typography and tell a little story. So this is how we got our site designed with content first. It's an overview of it, and how designing by content first means also that you're working towards an accessible site. And because we are using a relatively simple design, black and white, we know that there's not going to be any color blindness issues. It doesn't mean that it's automatically accessible, but you're kind of already on the way there. And because they know that I love big typography, also one of the websites that informed our design brief, as I said in another video, was the Van Gogh website. There's a lot of Dutch museums that we looked at. And this is a website that uses very big typography, and I made clear that they all knew that I really like it. See, and it's so clear, it's really impossible to miss. Everybody can read it, and graphically, it's beautiful. So this is one of the things that we bore in mind, and it's what we did. So it's content first design. I hope that this was useful. I really think that if you start designing with content first and accessibility in mind, you will by default design websites that will convert more for you and for your clients. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.